गुड आफ्टरनून डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर दिस फिफ्थ लेक्चर ऑफ सब्जेक्ट फंडामेंटल ऑफ सिस्टमैटिक्स। सो इन लास्ट फ्यू लेक्चर्स वी स्टडीड अबाउट द बायोलॉजिकल क्लासिफिकेशन, सो डिफरेंट किंगडम सिस्टम्स विच वर प्रपोज बाय डिफरेंट साइंटिस्ट। नाउ वी विल कंक्लूड दिस यूनिट नंबर वन ऑफ टैक्सोनॉमी एंड सिस्टमैटिक्स विद द लास्ट चैप्टर, दैट इज हायरार्की ऑफ टैक्सा एंड कैटेगरीज। So, our topic of discussion is hierarchy of taxa and categories. So, in your previous classes as well, you have studied the different hierarchy of classification. So, ranging from the highest classification level, that is domain, and the lowest classification level, that is species, or sometimes even up to subspecies level. So, here the highest category domain, it is the broad category, so the similarity is less, whereas at species level you become more specific. So the first question comes into mind, why there is need of this taxonomic hierarchy? So there are over more than 1 million species which have been recorded, and to organize them into proper groups, it becomes a very difficult task. So for this purpose, they need to be identified, described, as well as named, and then organized into a particular system. So such classification becomes a indispensable prerequisite. Okay, so it becomes a prerequisite for the identification, cataloging, arrangement of these different species which are identified over the period of time. Now there are different taxonomic categories, and before going into those categories, we will understand meaning of the terminology, that is hierarchy. What is mean by hierarchy? So in classification, the system of ranks which indicates categorical levels of various taxa. So ranging from the kingdom to species, these are normally used levels of organization. So this is referred to as hierarchy. And on the other hand, taxonomic category is designated to a level in this hierarchy classification. Okay, so we are going to discuss this in more details. So here these kingdom, phylum, class, order, all these are nothing but the taxonomic categories. Okay, so the Linnaeus was first to propose this hierarchy. So it is also referred to as Linnaean hierarchy. So he was first taxonomist to establish a definite hierarchy of taxonomic categories. He recognized only five basic categories, that is class, order, genus, species, and varieties. Later on, two additional categories were soon generally adapted when the number of animals grew, that means more number of animals were identified. So it required a finer division. So for this, two more categories were added, that is family, which was added between genus and order, and second category, that was phylum, it was added between the class and kingdom. Now this varieties, with this category which was used by Linnaeus, was an optional category, and it was later being replaced by the another category, that is subspecies. So remember that later on varieties was replaced by subspecies category. Okay, so we move on further. So suppose we take two examples, that is wolf and honeybee, and if we give the classification for these two species, the kingdom is Animalia, phylum for wolf is Chordata, on the other hand for honeybee it is Arthropoda. For wolf, the class is Mammalia. For honeybee, the class is Insecta. For wolf, the order is Carnivora, and for honeybees, order is Hymenoptera. Wolf family is Canidae and honeybee family is Apidae. Wolf genus is Canis, honeybee genus is Apis. Wolf species is Lupus and honeybee species is Meliphirador. So the scientific name of wolf is Canis lupus and the scientific name of honeybee is Apis mellifera. Now there are many species. This is just one example is given here. Okay, so now we move on to the next part. What is mean by taxon? So if we see the literal meaning of this word taxon, it has a Greek origin. In Greek, taxis means arrangement. So taxon is group of real organisms recognized as formal unit at any level of hierarchy classification. Or taxon is name of taxonomic group of any rank that is considered by taxonomist to be formally recognized and assigned to a definite category. So let's take one example to understand this. So the words like bluebirds, songbirds, vertebrates refer to the group of organisms. So such complete objects of zoological classification, okay, so such complete objects of zoological classification are nothing but the taxon. So taxon always refer to concrete zoological objects. Thus here species of robin is not a taxon, but it is a category, but robin itself is a taxon. Okay, so taxon must be recognized by the taxonomist within any large genus. Okay, so first within that particular genus you should identify a particular taxon. Okay, so we will see what is mean by category. So now category is any rank or level. So in this classification of organism, there are different levels at which we classify any organism. So these ranks or levels is nothing but the category. So category can also be defined as a class whose members are all the taxa assigned to a given rank. So for example, Homo sapiens or human beings, we classify them into following this order of categories. So kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species, all these become the different categories of taxonomic classification. So we'll see a simplified definition of category. So it is nothing but a class or a group in which we are placing all the organisms which are at the same level of hierarchic classification. So species is the lowest category. Sometimes you can also refer subspecies as the lowest category, and from genus you go to the higher categories like up to the kingdom or domain. So we can differentiate between taxa and category as taxa are always based on zoological realities, whereas categories are based on concepts. Okay, so all these categories like kingdom, division, class, order, family, genus, species, they are based on certain concepts, or rather some similarities or differences. Now there are different concepts of species which are proposed, which we will see in the next few slides. And there is a great deal of difference between the concept of species and the higher categories like the order, family, kingdom and all. So the category species can be defined by different ways. And these are the common hierarchical categories. So the topmost hierarchical categories, sometimes we can also go ahead of the kingdom to the domain level. So domain followed by kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species, and sometime you can also go to the more levels. And also there are in between levels, we will see in the next slide. In plant classification, instead of phylum, you have division. So, some more characteristics of taxonomic categories. As the number of known species increased, the need arose for more precise indication of taxonomic position of the species. So, since now more species are identified, you required a more need of more precise taxonomic categories. So, this was accomplished by splitting the original seven basic categories, which we saw in the previous slide, and additional categories were inserted between these seven categories. Okay. So, what are those new categories? We'll see in the next slide. So, this splitting and addition of new categories has resulted into a more precise classification system. So, you can see additional new category in the form of tribe between genus and family was introduced. So, tribe between the genus and family. Sometimes you can also come across this category, that is cohort. So, cohort is inserted between order and class. Okay. So, in this slide, you will see the most accepted categories as per the new classification system. So, you start with kingdom, then you have phylum, subphylum, superclass, class, subclass, cohort, superorder, order, suborder, superfamily, family, subfamily, tribe, genus, subgenus, species, and subspecies. So, if you are classifying a particular animal more precisely, you classify by following these 18 different categories. And you can see, as you go to the subspecies level, there is increased specificity. That means members belonging to a same subspecies, they are more closely related, whereas members belonging to a common kingdom, they have a decreased specificity or less similar characteristics. So, here you can see the previous seven categories which were proposed, and later on now we have added or we have increased them up to the 18. Okay, but in our discussion of today's lecture, we will stick to these seven obligate categories. So, the lowermost category is species. So, species occupies a key position in the classification. We always say that species is the basic unit for understanding taxonomy and evolution. Species can be defined as a genetically distinct and reproductively isolated natural population. That means only members of these population can interbreed between themselves. So, it is natural population of individual of group of population which resemble with one another in all the essential morphological and reproductive characters, carry out the same, or rather they carry the same type of genetic material, so they can freely interbreed among themselves under the natural condition, and they can produce the fertile offspring. So, this is the very important, that they can interbreed between themselves and they produce, always produce the fertile offspring. You must be aware a cross between donkey and horse, which results into mule. Okay, so that mule is not a species because it is not fertile. So, some examples of different species, like some plant species like Mangifera indica, potato, Solanum tuberosum. In animals, lion, the species name is Leo. Further, we have seen that species can be further classified into the category like subgroups, called as subspecies or varieties. So nowadays we do not use varieties, but we use the terminology subspecies. There is no rule of suffix for the species. Okay, now if we see the concept of species in detail, it is a static concept. There are different concepts. The first concept is known as static concept of species. It was given by Linnaeus. So according to him, species is fixed and immutable, because at that time there was no discovery of any genetics or law of genetics. So he defined them as fixed and immutable, so they do not have any mutation. On the other hand, the next concept was proposed by Lamarck, that is known as dynamic concept of species. So according to this concept, species is mutable and dynamic, so it continuously undergoes changes. Then the third concept was proposed, that is known as typological concept of species. It is the most accepted concept and most simple concept of the species. So according to this concept, there is an ideal pattern for each species. Individuals of the species match each other in all respect, and variation, if they are showing, is due to the imperfection of the physical world. So that means whatever variations are resulted due to the physical conditions of that particular organism. Now the next concept is called as nominalistic concept of species. According to this, species have no existence, only the individuals do so. This is not much accepted now, but we accept the concept, that is biological concept of species, which was given by Ernst Mayr, who is also the pioneer for taxonomy. And according to him, species is the fundamental unit of classification. So he classified the species in terms of classification. So species is group of organisms which are closely related, not only structurally as well as functionally. They share a common gene pool and they interbreed freely among themselves. So this is the population of individuals which can interbreed freely among themselves, and they always produce fertile offspring in the natural environment. Okay, so after this species, the lower most category, we move on to the higher category, that is genus, the second category. So it is category above the level of species. It is group of species which are related and have less character in common as compared to species. So we have seen in one slide, as you go higher in this classification level, the similarity decreases. So genus nothing but includes the closely related species, okay, and which are separated from each other by what? Nothing but the phylogeny. So they are related and there is some common phylogeny between the species of a particular genus. So in simple terminology, we can say that genus from evolutionary point of view is group of species that have descended from a common ancestor. Okay, so the species having a common ancestor and such related species give rise to the genus. Further, if we see the example of genus, so lion, scientific name is Panthera leo, leopard, Panthera pardus, tiger, Panthera tigris, jaguar, Panthera onca. So all these are the cat family members and in which the genus is common. So they share some similarities, that's why all these members belong to the same genus, that is Panthera. So a genus may be monotypic, that means it has a single species, or sometimes it can be polytypic. So for example, of a monotypic, Homo sapiens is the monotypic, but on the other hand, Panthera, this example, where we have multiple of species, so it is the example of polytypic. All the species of number of common features called as correlated characters. So they share some common characters. And why these common characters are present? Because they have the common ancestor. Okay, now similar to species, there is no suffix to the genus. So that means each species name is unique. It does not end with some common ending. Generic name always begins with capital letter. So in binomial nomenclature, you always write the genus name with a capital letter, and if it is printed, you make it in a italic. On the other hand, species name always starts with a small letter. Okay, now we move on to the next higher category of classification, that is family. So family are nothing but a group of related genera. So the similar genera having some common characteristics, they come together to form a give rise to a single family. So all the genera of family resemble with one another in some or other character, because they also share a common ancestor. Okay, so for example, lion, leopard, tiger, jaguar, they all belong to the genus Panthera, and they belong to the cat family members. So the family name is Felidae. Similarly, you can take example of plants. In plants, family name ends with the suffix A-C-E-A-E, and subfamily name always ends with O-I-D-A-E. Okay, like in genus and species, we have seen that there is no suffix, but here you come across a suffix. Similarly, for animals, we are more interested in animals. So the suffix for the family is I-D-E-A-E. And for subfamily, it is always INAE. Okay, we move on to the next higher category, that is order. So it is related families come together to give rise to order. So it is assembly of families resembling one another with in terms of few characters. So these characters are less similar as compared to the genera put in a family. That means in family, the number of similarities are more as compared to the order level, where the similarities now goes on decreasing. So order Carnivora contains related families of Canidae, Felidae, Ursidae and Hyaenidae. So Canidae means all the canine bearing members, Felidae, cat family members, Ursidae, bear belong all the bear family members, and Hyaenidae includes all the hyena members. Okay, now we move on to the next top category above the order, that is class. So it is taxonomic category made up of one or more related orders. So one or more than one related orders will give rise to what is known as class. So for example, Mammalia is a class which has number of orders like Carnivora, Rodentia, Insectivora. Now here there is a suffix. So in the class name always ends with a P-H-Y-C-E-A-E, or it ends with O-P-S-I-D-A, or it ends with A-E in plants only. So suffix is not fixed in case of animal. It can be this or it can be this, but in plants it is fixed, that is A. Classes were the most common rank proposed by the Linnaeus. There are about 100 and different classes in the kingdom Animalia as proposed by the Linnaeus, and these are still followed by the today's classification system. Now there are, we look at the important classes of the animal kingdom, that is aves, mammalia, reptilia, amphibia and pisces. Now we move on to the category above class, that is phylum, or in plants it is called as division. So phylum or division consists of one or several related classes. So several related classes come together to give rise to phylum. They also show some similar characters, that's why they are included in the common phylum. In animals we have phylum Chordata, which includes different classes like pisces, amphibia, reptilia, aves and mammals. The division always has a suffix like phyta, and a subdivision has an ending phytina. Okay, now we move on to the topmost category, that is kingdom. It includes all organisms which share some common characters. It is the highest category of biological classification. Plants are put in kingdom Plantae and animals are put into the kingdom Animalia. So we have seen this in the R.H. Whitaker system, that five kingdom classification system, which includes Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. Okay, so what is the basis for doing this or defining these different categories? So while classifying any organism, you compare their phenotype and genotypes. So taxonomists compare any new specimen with the set of some characteristics. So what are these characteristics? You are not only dependent on the morphology, but you will also see anatomy, you will also study behavior, embryological characters, protein structuring, karyotyping and DNA sequencing, also referred to as DNA fingerprinting. Okay, so these are the levels at which you study that particular organism and then assign it to the particular category. So last slide, we'll conclude that hierarchy of characters are used to define a taxon. One character is not always enough, so many characteristics you are using, as we seen in the previous slide. So different levels you are studying that particular levels of organization, and then you group it into particular hierarchy. So with this we conclude today's lecture. Today we studied about the different hierarchy of taxa. We understood the meaning of taxon and meaning of category, what is the difference between them. Then we studied the Linnaean categories, then how new categories were added to that, and the recent classification system has 18 categories, and out of that the 7 basic categories we studied in detail. So with this we conclude today's lecture. Thank you for your patience hearing.